The Lord be with you. Well, good morning, fine folk. How are you doing? It is always a privilege to look out and see your giggling faces at this moment, because you know that I like to have fun, and you've kind of checked in with that, and I am grateful. Let's take a couple of seconds to see where we are as a congregation and do our greetings and our good work. For those of you who have a pencil or something to write with, please add to the prayer list the name of Terry, who is Josephine Usher's nephew by marriage. Terry is the one who gets Josephine here and gets her home. He has a fellowship, a faith fellowship of his own, but he makes sure she gets here. He is in the hospital and needs our prayers so that they can discern how to help him get on the road to healing. That name was Terry, nephew of Josephine Usher. I want a name like that. Josephine Usher. I like it. What other praises would you lift this day? Birthdays, anniversaries, celebrations, good news. Yes?
I don't know whether this is good news or not, but they have moved Lorraine again. She still is under quarantine through today. Hopefully she will go home Wednesday, but her knee is healed up.
Lord, we praise your name, and together we say,
Hallelujah.
And we cannot wait to get our Lorraine back here. Sound folk, I just brought my headset up to my head, so I'm hot now. And I apologize to you, I get ahead of myself. What other praises? I know we've got one other birthday, because I've heard about it for 3 weeks in a row. Come on. Yeah. Who'd have thought you'd let her make it that far along? Lord, we praise your name, and together we say,
Hallelujah.
Tell the girl we wish her happy birthday. Others? Friends, just for the good of the order, to keep you up to speed, next Sunday at 4 o'clock, the Fiber Art Fellowship will be meeting at 4 o'clock. Now, in my world, fiber art means mending, because I never take the time to mend, or you can crochet, or you can Rachel, you just come and talk. She did that last time, huh? Make her cards. It is truly a chance to get together, check in with each other. We're going to do some encouragements, but that's primarily, it's a new group, so we're finding our way. Not yet. Are you bringing it this week? There you go. Watch your mouth, Bucky. I'll catch you. No, I'm just teasing. I would share with you it is in the bulletin, but the flowers on the altar are from Sandy in gratitude for all of you. And that is a beautiful gift. Please take a moment. Don't run out of here without checking out the two new tables that are in our, you can call it a fellowship hall. Some of us have started calling it the friendship hall. There are two new tables. One has some experiences for young ones to play. If they ever come, they would have entertainment in their seat. And I'm just going, build it and they will come. The other table is we have welcoming bags for folk who are first-time attenders. One of the things that we put our head around is that if you constantly point out that somebody's new, they'll never come back. If you say, if you'd like to give us your numbers, we will follow up. It puts the power in their hands. So you'll see that there's been some really good attention to detail, and I give thanks for the mission team who's making this stuff happen, and it's just wonderful joy on off to you. If you want, let me put a spiritual dimension to it. When you go by those tables, if you touch the table and lift a prayer that it may soon be used, not a bad thing to do. Prayer is our power tool right now, and we are doing it every which way we can figure out. Please also remember that we are heading into Lent. February 22nd is Ash Wednesday. We all have a service of the imposition of ashes here at 6 o'clock. Now, that was a very intentional decision to make it at that hour so that we could embrace the breadth of all folk, those who have to work and those who don't like to be out late at night. So that's the reason for the 6, and we'll enjoy that. It will not be a full hour. It will be a bit shorter than that, but we will offer the imposition of ashes on that day. Friends, these are just some of the things that we are about. Take time to read your bulletin. Don't leave it in the pew. Take it home with you. Enjoy it. Make it your prayer guide. I'm seeing Bev wiggling her hands. What you need, Bev? Thank you, Bev. In case you didn't catch it, Sandy was going to be here today. She even told me Thursday she would see us Sunday. Her bank accounts have been hacked. She is now online trying to get that straightened out. It just keeps coming for that family. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, we thank you for the privilege of praying for our sisters, our brothers, each other in this day. And as we now prepare to light the Christ candle, we take this time and the power of music to turn our full attention to the worship of the Lord on this day in this house. Let us be in this moment.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Would you stand as you are able and join me in the responsive call to worship? Happy are those who worship the Lord and delight in God's precepts.
They rise before dawn as a light to the upright.
They are gracious, merciful, and righteous.
They shine their light before others for all the world to see.
They will never be moved.
Let us worship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I invite you to join me in singing our opening hymn, number 2236 in The Faith We Sing, Gather Us In. The words will be on the screen. Here in this place, new light is streaming. Now is the darkness vanished away. See in this space our fears and our dreaming, brought here to you in the light of this day. Gather us in the lost and forsaken, gather us in the blind and the lame. Call to us now and we shall awaken, we shall arise at the sound of our name. We are the young, our lives are a mystery. We are the old, who yearn for your face. We have been sung throughout all of history, call to the light of the whole human race. Gather us in the rich and the haughty, gather us in the proud and the strong. Give us a heart so meek and so lowly, give us the courage to enter the song. Here we will take the wine and the water, here we will take the bread of new birth. Here you shall call your sons and your daughters, call us anew to be salt of the earth. Give us to drink the wine of compassion, give us to eat the bread that is you. Nourish us well and teach us to fashion lives that are holy and hearts that are true. Not in the dark of buildings confining, not in some heaven light years away, but here in this place the new light is shining. Now is the kingdom, now is the day. Gather us in and hold us forever, gather us in and make us your own. Gather us in, all peoples together, fire of a love in all our flesh and our bone. Thank you. You may be seated.
Our Psalter reading is from Psalm 112, verses 1 through 10. This is the blessings of the righteous. Praise the Lord. Happy are those who fear the Lord, who greatly delight in his commandments. Their descendants will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in their houses, and their righteousness endures forever. They rise in the darkness as a light for the upright. They are gracious, merciful, and righteous. It is well with those who deal generously and lend, who conduct their affairs with justice. For the righteous will never be moved. They will be remembered forever. They are not afraid of evil tidings. Their hearts are firm, secure in the Lord. Their hearts are steady. They will not be afraid. In the end, they will look in triumph on their foes. They have distributed freely. They have given to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. Their horn is exalted in honor. The wicked see it and are angry. They gnash their teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked comes to nothing. The word of the Lord for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
God.
It is fitting and right as the people gather to speak the names of those who we have in our hearts as a community, as a consistency, as the presence of the living Lord. So as we turn our attention to our time of prayer, please know that this prayer rail is for you to use as the Spirit guides you. It is a good thing. Let us speak these names aloud of those whom we carry. We remember in prayer Sandy and Terry, Dwayne and Sarah, Randy and Bethany, Lorraine and Tori, our adopt a family, Marcus, Barb and Fred, Janice and Shelton, Trevor and Grammy, Ellie and Rick, Barb and Ron, Arlene and Bev, Jean and Kieran, Brenzel and Linda, Bob and Karen, the people of the Ukraine, the people of Russia, the need for peace in Europe, the power of peace for all the world. We speak the name of Kay, Ralph and Millie, Will and Linda, Dana and Marion, Colleen, Leo, and Janice. And as we place our hands upon our hearts, we speak those names that we carry deep in silence, knowing that you have ears to hear. Lord, in your mercy, our prayers continue with those who are a part of the hard work of healing in the presence of cancer. We give thanks for the way in which they work day and night. They offer their full attention to the healing. We remember those who stand beside them, the medical teams everywhere who seek to bring the best they have and the power of discernment. We also would lift to you the scientists who endeavor to see what could be, what might be, what is possible, so that all might someday see the new sense of healing. Lord, in your mercy, Almighty God, it is not an accident that this congregation would turn its face to those who serve this country as military members. Right outside our doors are institutions that attend to this hard and difficult work. We remember that there are those who love them so deeply that whatever happens is shared by all. And it is with great humbleness, O Lord, that we seek that you teach us that the day is coming when war shall not be taught and righteousness shall call down like streams. Lord, in your mercy, my friends, I would ask you to rise as you are able, in your heart or with your feet, as we sing the prayer, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God." During the singing of this hymn, the first verse twice, you are invited to gather at the prayer rail.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia. One more time. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia.
A parish prayer.
A reminder that we do this work of life together. A petition to say we are not alone. We especially are not alone from you, O God. It is with humble courage that we remember that you do not desire a feast of sackcloth and ashes, but a fast of righteousness. You ask us to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of a heavy yoke, to set free those who are captive. O Lord God, train our hearts to do what is right and good and an encouragement to the world. It will not be easy, for it may have nothing to do with us, but may have everything to do with brightening this world with your love. May we live our days along with those who are righteous, that we may never be moved and may dwell secure in your mercy and your grace as we humbly offer this prayer together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We'll sing the second verse now. Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. Alleluia, alleluia.
The gospel reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. Salt and light. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. People do not light a lamp and put it under the bushel basket. Rather, they put it on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. The Law and the Prophets. Do not think that I have come to abolish the Law or the Prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter, will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. The word of the Lord for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Beloved, in a service of worship, we gather to do the good work that honors the one who gave us life, to know that each moment is a possibility of the inbreaking of the Holy Spirit. The privilege of responding to this overwhelming love is often called the offertory. May it be a blessing to you to give your gifts this day to the one who gave them to you first. Let us be in this time of offering.
Faith on Thursday gave me just a little more grace. On Friday told me to watch and pray. On Saturday told me just what to say. On Sunday gave me the power divine just to let my little light shine.
O radiant one, source of every good gift, we thank you for the light you shine in our lives. We praise you for the joy you bring to our hearts. Receive these gifts that we bring to you this day, that they may loosen the bonds of injustice, undo the thongs of the yokes, feed the hungry, and find a way for the oppressed to go free. Bless this offering and the ministries it supports, that your light may chase away the shadows in places that are lost to hopelessness and despair. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, and together we say, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Will you tolerate a story from me that was not meant for the sermon? When I walked in yesterday and saw the tables with the kids' activities and the bags to welcome and greet those who are first-time attenders, I just giggled. There was a church I went into who had a very much the idea that worship was a lecture. Y'all come in, y'all sit down, y'all shut up, y'all receive, y'all go home. And yes, I lived in Nashville, Tennessee, and y'all is a wonderful word. There was a desire amongst some to engage more the power of prayer in worship than previously experienced. So, quite honestly, we began this process of calling the communion rail the prayer rail, the fence, whatever you wanted to. And they got very excited about how ages and ages ago, this fence that used to be solid and only the highly lifted up, exalted ones could stand on this. Hey, Marty, we need to go. Yeah, we need to go down because we are not. Yeah. All right. And so this concept that the wall was broken between the Holy of Holies and the working floor of the laity just got really exciting, and they were busting out with it. So we started the prayer rail process, and it has been something that I have learned from church to church, some of the nuances of what prayer can be. So for a year and a half, we opened the prayer rail and we had the hymn singing so that people could come up without being too obvious and then move back after the prayer. For a year and a half, this was offered. Somebody came to me and said, Pastor, aren't you about ready to give that up? It's not working. And I said, no. Have you noticed I know how to say no? I said, no. We're going to keep doing this. Because if there is one instrument that we can all get together on, it is the power of prayer, especially when it's offered in a way for each of us to bring our uniquenesses. After a year and a half of opening the prayer rail, putting feet on our face, allowing God to hear what's in our hearts, it was like something happened. And it was a never quiet or empty prayer rail after that year and a half. Even to the point that some folk who could no longer kneel at the prayer rail stood by the prayer rail to engage at that time. It became a place of quiet hugs and gentle care and supportive. Have you ever been in a prayer where people came up behind you and laid their hands upon your shoulders gently to let you know you were not alone? It is overwhelming at times. So every day, every time we gather, there is going to be a dimension of our worship that works for you. And there's going to be our dimension of worship that doesn't work for you. But remember, we are eclectic. We are diverse. We are all on our spiritual journeys, faithful to the path that God has given us. And so whatever we do, If it is something that encourages you, be encouraged. If it is something that encourages someone else, then give thanks. It's encouraging them. So whether we have children or not, whether we have visitors or not, when any of them walk in, may they know we got ready for their presence. Amen. Friends, will you join me in prayer as we turn our attention to the encouragement and interpretation of our scriptures that have guided us so far, our hymns that have guided us so far, our prayers that have guided us so far, as we might seek for the encouragement of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. And now, Almighty God, either through or in spite of this, thy servant, speak to these, your beloved ones, that they may hear your encouragement through the offerings that are laid open this morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, and together we say, Amen. I know I have spoken before that this is the first Christmas 2022. It was the first Christmas I ever hosted Christmas dinner. Ever. I have always finished Christmas Eve service, tucked it in bed really quick, jumped in the car, and headed someplace. It's been my tradition. I remember the Christmas where the heater was gone out of the car. It was sub-zero, and I had 2 hours and 15 minutes to go, and it was snowing, and I prayed the whole way there, and I was never so relieved to get there. Friends, Christmas is an adventure in my book, but this year it was really an adventure because I had planned out the dinner. The family was coming, we were going to eat after the service was over. So, you know, I had done the clock. Well, if this goes in then and that goes in then, when we come home after Christmas Eve service, we can chow down. Open presents. Totally be full of joy and delight. God kind of took care of that for me, didn't God? All of a sudden I went, well, what do you do when you don't have to do Christmas Eve? First of all, you never get done with Christmas Eve because you miss it. It's just true. And you all didn't get to meet my family, and that ticked me off. Because it's rare to get my family to churches. They all go to church, they just do it in their own way. Anyway, so we're sitting at the table that's all laid out with Christmas tablecloth and the candles are lit and I have very traditional food to be eaten. One of them was a spiral ham. Woohoo! I love me some spiral ham. And you want to know why I got it? I wanted leftovers. We popped everything out of the oven. I'm really good at setting a table. I put the hot stuff on the stove. I give everybody a serving spoon and say, go for it. Get what you want. Come and sit down. We'll break bread together. It was wonderful. And we started to eat, and I took the first bite of ham because I'm starting with the ham. And I went, this is a little salty. Took a bite of the hot German potato salad. This is a little salty too. Maybe it's just me. Hey, you guys, is this food salty or is it just, no. It's really good, Mary Jo. Translation, yes, it's salty. And so we proceeded through dinner, and I watched my sister as she would take the broccoli that was steamed without salt, and she would join it in union with the ham that was salty, and eat of one bite in a balancing kind of fashion. Hey, you know what? You know you're loved when people say, "This is a great dinner. Thank you very much," even though you know full well it isn't. But I would offer that it was the first Christmas Eve I've cooked in 44 years. So there you go. You get what you get. Here's the thing. I love salt. If you were to come to my house, you would see that I have ground pink Himalayan salt. I have finely ground pink Himalayan salt. I have iodized regular salt. I have the kind of salt that you pickle with. I have sea salt. Somebody's going, yeah. Anybody else does this? You know, so when I was young, salt was salt was salt. Salt does add flavor. After the dinner was over and things were all packed up, the next day, sibling and her husband were off the road, heading out west to spend 2 days driving through that weather. God bless them. I just prayed for them. Go. I pulled out the ham and said, "What the heck am I going to do with you? That's a lot of ham, a lot of money. Didn't want to throw it away." So I began to think, and somehow the idea of creating ham and cabbage soup sounded really good. So I whacked me up all that ham, and I shoved it in a great big cooker, and I cooked that stuff until it didn't taste too salty anymore. And I have more ham and cabbage soup in my freezer than I know what to do with. Anybody want some lunch? I could get some for you. Ready? You coming? Hey, you know what? I'm going to start doing dinners. I'm going to say, if you like, here, you can have a choice. You can have ham and cabbage, or you can have turkey and bean sprout soup. Ooh, liking this? I have all kinds of stuff in my freezer. But it really took some work for me to address the issue that the salt in the ham that I did not curate was either a throwaway or I was going to have to work. And so I chose to work. And by the way, by the grace of God, and I mean it, I figured it out. And it's fine. Our scripture has reminded us that salt is power. It can bring out savoriness and excite your taste. Do you know it's a stimulant to your body? It gets you going. It gets your little taste buds popping. Salt and pepper are called seasoning in the professional world. If you under-season, you will hear about it. If you over-season, you will get blasted for it. Just watch Top Chef. Mm-hmm. And I'm going, listening to this salt conversation, going, this is something that the people of God have thought about. Some of us are a little boring. We're not willing to adventure in any way. We are unwilling to take risks and try new things. We leave ourselves dull and limp. And won't risk. And then there are others who come off with so much salt, you can barely stand being in their presence. They dry you out. They suck you dry. They leave you wanting a whole lot less salt. Dear friends, there is this thing called potluck. Anybody done a good potluck lately? I cannot wait till we start doing them again. I can't wait for that time, and I want to tell you a story about one particular potluck. It was in my first appointment just out of seminary. We were doing a Wednesday night potluck. all summer long. Wednesday night, because in that area of God's beautiful world, there was the Finger Lake region, and I don't care who you were, you had a cottage on a lake in the Finger Lake region, and guess what you did on the weekends? You didn't stick around and go to church. So we had this great idea. Let's meet people where they are. Who says that church has to be Sunday morning only? So we started Sunday morning worship on Wednesday evening, and we had potluck, and one of the families would design the worship service with the guidance of a pastor, because we had two of those dudes running around. And every Wednesday night, we would have potluck in the middle of the week. It was, oh! Have you ever been disappointed at a potluck? I have. One night we rolled in and we looked at the spread. I call it the spread of the blonde food. Can you see it? Potatoes, macaroni, rice, one bowl of salad. It was gone before half of us got there. It was the meal of the blonde food. Crackers, potato chips, empty calories for those of us who watch our figures. And that's what it was. Guess what happened to that United Methodist congregation? They got themselves organized. If your last name begins with an A to a G, you bring a veggie or a salad. If your name, and they did the whole thing, and we were all regimented to respond. It never happened again. But all you have to do is have one experience to remind you of the power of savoriness and balance and looking for a sense of inclusion for it all, to bring a light that sees all the people, not just the ones that you're comfortable with. This is the reflection of this scripture from what can be seen. It's fine to know that salt has power, but if you use too much, your power overwhelms and you just burn out. If you don't bring yourself to the party, you just become so dull that you don't matter. The energy of balance is throughout the gospel. How it is that healing is more about the balance of coming into wholeness. It is the energy that we work together. And so the potluck dinner can often mean a wonderful way of finding the unity of coming together in our diversity. There are times when scripture is read and hymns are sung, and you say, that was nice, let's go home. My prayer for you this day is that either through the table of the Lord that we will share this day, or through a hymn that you have sung, that a word was spoken in such a way that it caught your attention, that you will not be burningly salty or boringly absent in the living of this week. Pick one thing that encouraged you, that caught your attention, and meditate upon it, and add to it your actions of courage and faith. And let's see where we are a week from now, as we gather to worship God, as we gather in the presence of the table of our Lord, as we remember the presence of the living Christ. Amen. Friends, this is the Sunday where we use more untraditional hymns and more charismatic prayers and Our pianist just takes us for a ride every time, and I love it. So today, in honor of our more contemporary style, I would like to share communion with you in what many of us now call the Emmaus style of blessing communion. We will not be using the screen for reflections. It will simply be my voice. And Charlie, I'm sorry for not warning you about that. Friends, we gather at a table. There's no front, there's no back. There's no in, there's no out. There's but one table. And this is the table of the Lord, which means it is Jesus who breaks the bread and offers and pours out the cup for you. With gratitude in our hearts, we give thanks for the way in which, as a group called the United Methodists, we understand that all are welcome to the table of the Lord. So you need not be a United Methodist. You need not be a member of this congregation. You are asked but two questions. One, do you see in the way that Jesus lives the way that you want to live? Welcoming strangers into your hearts, breaking bread with those who are close by, offering food to those who have none. If that is your hope and that is your desire, if you will offer your life to do those things, you say yes. If then you will take this overwhelming sense of love that Jesus has for you and me and offer it to the neighbor you may not even know. If that is your true desire, this table has been prepared for you that you might eat and drink and be encouraged. Amen. Beloved ones, on the night in which, hear this, on the night in which he turned his ministry over to his disciples, the night in which he turned his ministry over to you, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Amen. And likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup. Again, he returned thanks to you. And he gave it to his disciples. And he said, "Drink of this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves as a living, outward and visible sign of your deep and passionate love. Make us one with you, one with each other, and one in service and ministry to all the world. And together we say, amen. My friends, I would ask for those who have offered to serve communion to come forward at this time. As they do so, I remind you that the lotion for your hands is here. Hi, Zach. Marty, I'm going to ask you to help me. As they prepare to receive, will you take that? And I will take this. And we'll need two over here and two over here. As they prepare, I remind you that it is our practice. We're starting from the front. I know I keep changing things on you, but it's not a lecture, it's an experience. To come forward to receive the bread and the cup, You'll find bowls at the end to receive the cups that you no longer need and return to your pew on the side aisles. I am grateful for the privilege of serving. We are grateful for the privilege of being salt to the world, light to the darkness. Here we go. Did it this way. Oh, good. You are invited.
There are those who would be served in their pews, I will come to you. Jesus Christ, and together we say, Amen.
I invite you to rise as you are able and join us in singing our closing hymn. It's number 572 in the United Methodist Hymnal. Pass it on. It only takes a spark to get a fire going, and soon all those around can warm up in its glowing. That's how it is with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you spread His love to everyone. You want to pass it on. What a wondrous time is spring, when all the trees are budding. The birds begin to sing, the flowers start their blooming. That's how it is with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you want to sing. It's fresh like spring. You want to pass it on. I wish for you, my friend, this happiness that I've found. You can depend on him. It matters not where you're bound. I'll shout it from the mountaintop. I want my world to know the Lord of love has come to me. I want to pass it on.
Zach, I am sorry. I got so into the hymn that I forgot to get you up here. Come on up here. Quick, quick, quick. Run, run, run. Got to take the light of Christ out. And since it's all about salt and light today, it's important for us to see the outward invisible sign of what our hearts hope to do. Amen?
Amen.
You are the salt of the earth. Keep walking. So be salty, but be in balance. You are light of the world, and let your light so shine that justice shall be seen and righteousness encouraged. Be like the city on a hill that cannot be hid. Go forth with blessing of one who made you salt and light. And the people said, amen.
Amen.
Huh? Apparently not.
Check the mic.
Oh, it's hot.